Thank you very much. Obviously, I'm very delighted to be asked to introduce Michael Watts, tonight's speaker. I will be brief because that's Michael's wish, as the modest person that he is. He's, as has been said, professor of geography at the University of California in Berkeley, where he has taught for almost four decades. Has served various functions there, among other things, director at the Institute of International Studies. And his research has addressed important a number of development issues, especially food security, pertaining to land, to resources, conflict in Africa, but also to some extent in South Asia and Vietnam. Over the past 10 to 15 years, I would say, he has devoted much of his time and endless energy into studying the oil sector, the oil industry, especially in West Africa, in Nigeria, and Nigeria's Niger Delta, and has written extensively about the subject. One of the recent major works is The Curse of the Black Gold, in which he, together with a photographer, Ed Kashi, documents the startling consequences of 50 years of oil production in Nigeria's Niger Delta. You will not be surprised to learn that he has, throughout his career, received a lot of recognition for his work, and some of it, for example, by the Royal Geographical Society and the Guggenheim Foundation. Michael would not be Michael if he would lock himself into the ivory tower, so he has gone out and has worked a lot with NGOs, non-profit sector. He has provided expert testimony for governmental organizations and some other forums where we've actually, unlikely as it is, seems, met at, well, an American institution, let's say. Michael's work has been extremely influential. For those of you who are perhaps not as familiar with Nigeria and his work, I really have to mention that. And it's a major point of reference for anybody who works on Nigeria, on the Niger Delta, but also more widely on the political economy of conflict in resource-rich countries. Part of the explanation is probably because his work is, in the best sense of the word, interdisciplinary. In his case, he combines anthropology, ecology, sociology, and an interest for development theory. Another one is that he's actually asking big, big real-life questions, and I think that's something that is also having a huge impact in terms of the political economy of development and conflict. Beginning with his first book based on his fieldwork, long-term fieldwork in northern Nigeria. So I don't know if you agree with me, Michael, but perhaps with the project that we will hear about today, maybe your scholarship is also coming full circle to the extent that your long-standing interest in northern Nigeria now also combines with your more recent, perhaps, interest, or more recent is probably an exaggeration, in the Niger Delta, as you will throw some light on the reasons why there are two major insurgency movements in Nigeria, one in the north, Boko Haram, which has received a lot of coverage worldwide, and the Delta. My last point would just be to say that these questions really matter greatly, because Nigeria is of major strategic importance for many, many reasons for West Africa, for the continent, and probably also for Europe in times that we talk a lot about migration and so on and so forth. But it's also because of the underlying theme of this lecture, which I gather will be the crisis of youth, the politics of contestation, of existing political orders, which for many young people are not legitimate, perhaps, anymore, or not providing what they are expected to do. And I think we will recognize some of this, although in different forms of articulation also in Europe, if you think of what's happening in Italy, in Greece, and in Spain. So please welcome Michael Watts, and I'm looking forward to this lecture. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dennis. You know, it's always a little dubious when you have a friend introduce the speaker. You know, the facts tend to be a little elastic, you know, and I wish I was half as accomplished as Dennis suggests. And it occurred to me that it's one of the reasons why I love that New Yorker cartoon, perhaps you've seen it, of someone like Dennis introducing someone like me. And Dennis says, well, of course, Professor Watts is known for his work on Nigeria and Boko Haram, but he's mostly known for being a royal pain in the ass. But of course, academics are utterly shameless, and we'll accept any type of compliments we can get, so thank you very much. Okay, this is a type of biblical moment. We've had earthquakes in central Italy, and now we have fire in Nicolazzi, so I hope this is not foreboding moment. Let me begin then with a word of thanks from my sponsors, as it were. First of all, the Academy. They have extended a type of generosity to my family, to my wife and my daughter here, that I couldn't possibly repay. Let me give a shout out to Ashley Bamford and Thomas Heller, who arranged this wonderful event this evening, including pumpkin pies, which will be coming afterwards. But they're not at all responsible for anything that I have to say, though I'd like to blame them if you don't like the talk. I am the Siemens Fellow here, and I'd like to support the acknowledge the generosity of the foundation. And of course, the fellows that are here, they're a very diverse, very heterogeneous, convivial, hard-drinking group. I've learned a lot from them. And I want to give a particular shout out to my co-fellow, Daniel Martinez, from whom I've learned an enormous amount just in the short time of being here. And I've come to value his comradeship and his friendship very, very much. Last but not least, we have two visitors here from the Nigerian embassy. Kenneth Oke, Chargé d'Affaires, and Joseph Muro, political minister. I really appreciate in your very busy schedules coming all this way. I'm very moved and touched by your presence here. I'm not sure whether you'll agree with too much of what I have to say about your country, but what I do know is that Nigeria has one of the most robust intellectual cultures in the world. To quote one of our fellows here, the arts of disputation are deep and profound in that country, and I have no doubt that if you disagree with me, they will make it known. All right, so to business then. One of the hallmarks of this of these talks that we've had by the fellows is their diversity. I'm going to keep with that. I'm going to jump from the history of Germany and so on to the global south, to the African continent, and to the state of post-colonial politics. And I'm going to be looking quite specifically at Nigeria. Let me stop. Happy Halloween. I have some visual aids. You Berliners here have a world-class licorice store. Do you know this in Kreuzberg? Have you done called Cardo? It's stupendous. So please take them, pass them around. They are fantastic. And happy Halloween. Okay. All right, so I'm going to be talking then about the politics of post-colonial Africa, looking at Nigeria in particular, and I'm going to be looking at two insurgencies that have arisen in that country since the return to civilian rule in 1999. Some of you probably know Nigeria became independent in 1960, former British colony, and was presided over, ruled over by a series of serial military governments for the most part after falling into a civil war in the 1960s, as you know. And I'm going to look at these two insurgencies. And just for those of you who are not political scientists, by insurgency, I'm simply referred to armed non-state actors who are engaged in some type of rebellion, some type of militancy against state authority. So I'm going to be talking about two in very different parts of the country. One in the northeast here, and the other in the on the oil fields of the Niger Delta. They're very different geographies. The north of the country is primarily Sunni Muslim. This is a Hausa and Kanuri speaking area. And the south here is a multi-ethnic, probably 60 to 70 so-called ethnic minorities that inhabit this part of the world, and primarily Pentecostal and evangelical Christian. These two insurgencies are on their face extraordinarily different, draped in very different types of political register. Boko Haram, you've almost certainly heard of. They both emerged, as I said, after the return to civilian rule in 1999. Boko Haram is an insurgency that is still in train. Just last week, actually, there was a major attack in Gashigar in, near the Niger border, in which a number of military were killed. And the second is in the Niger Delta, and I'm going to be talking about this. This is the Movement for the Emancipation of the Niger Delta. MEND is the acronym. Both of these figures are just a measure of the nature of the crisis that these insurgencies represent. These were attacks that were launched at different times by these organizations in the center of the capital city, Abuja, in Nigeria. So these are the two insurgencies then that I'm going to be talking about. Now, Nigeria is arguably, as Dennis was talking previously, the dominant presence in sub-Saharan Africa. It's an enormously complex, vibrant, rambunctious country, close to 200 million people. One in every five sub-Saharan Africans is a Nigerian. It's multi-ethnic. Depending on how you define ethnicity, there are somewhere between 300 and 400 ethno-linguistic groups in the country. It's a strongly regionalized economy marked by sharp communal and religious divisions between a largely Sunni Muslim north and Christian southeast and a Muslim and Christian mixed southwest. And large, and it has a political system that is in some sense comparable to the United States. It's a complex federal system consisting of 36 states and roughly just under 800 local government areas. And last but not least, it's a major oil producer. Some of you will, the ninth largest actually oil and gas producer in the world. Some of you will remember in the wake of the September 11 attacks, Mr. Cheney, then vice president, famously came to the conclusion that perhaps Saudi Arabia and certain Mideast countries were not actually great friends of the United States, and that he that the United States should think about diversifying its supply to the Gulf of Guinea, West Africa, Nigeria in particular, which produces so-called sweet crude, low sulfur oil, which is highly valuable for the gasoline market. So this is just a thumbnail sketch, and let me just say, I realize some of you know more about Nigeria than I do. Some of you probably know almost nothing. So I'm going to try to carve out a middle ground here that I hope is neither condescending nor, in fact, presumes too much. What is incontestable, then, is that since the return to civilian rule in Nigeria, that it has been marked by considerable political violence, religious, ethnic, electoral, and that these two insurgencies represent a profound crisis of legitimacy for the state. Article in Atlantic, Nigeria too big to fail. Now, I want to address then these two insurgencies, very different in character and tone. And I want to suggest, however, make an argument that in fact they have very similar, what I will call conditions of possibility. In spite of their difference, they arose from a set of structural conditions that are quite similar, and those structural similarities actually give these very different insurgencies certain sorts of commonalities. And to suggest then that in doing that, we can think about these insurgencies not, as is often the case, of simply aspects of what are called state failure or failed state or poor governance, but perhaps we can dig a little deeper into that. By way of personal background, I went to Nigeria when I was a young man, right after the end of the Civil War, 1971. For those of you who are not American, Charles Manson was a serial killer. I went there, I built schools in the northwest of the country. I taught for a while, I did many things. It was a transformative experience. And over the years, I went back then to do my dissertation work. I lived in a village in northern Nigeria looking at food and food security issues. And I've been going back to Nigeria regularly ever since. And I've been very lucky along the way to be able to have been educated and work with some utterly brilliant Nigerians. These names may not mean anything but to many of you, but to Kenneth and Joseph, they will. Bala Usman, Aronto Douglas, Professor A.J. Alagwa, Ken Wiwa, who tragically died, as you know, just 10 days ago. Okay. Insofar as I'm sorry to keep the slide up there. I'm just going to have to do that. It's ugly, I know. Insofar as I realize that you have different backgrounds with respect to this, what I thought I would do is to give you my argument up front. And then if I present, as I have to, some details on these insurgencies, I hope that you can at least retain that argument. My students in Berkeley say this is always a good pedagogy, because if you tell them what you want to say right up front, they can then take a nap, and if they wake up about 45 minutes later, they can pretty much pick up where you left off. So let me then try to lay out for you as clearly as I can the arguments. I want to make this type of argument, that these two very different types of insurgencies arose from a type of common ether. One is draped in the language of Islam, Islamic restoration, the resurrection of the caliphate, the implementation of Sharia law. The other, mend, is draped in the language of the secular world, of constitutional reform, of resource control, of getting a better and more just distribution of the oil revenues and the oil which is located in that region. These movements certainly arose from a crisis of what we could call national secular development, but rather than just seeing that as a type of failed or conflicted state, or rather that these movements arose in context of structural poverty, both of these reasons indeed are poor, okay. Rather than making those types of argument, I'd like to try to make a rather different argument. And I want to say that to understand the commonalities and why these arose, I want to suggest that you have to locate them at the intersection of what I'm going to call a youth crisis and the precarious conditions that young men in particular, I'm going to be focusing almost exclusively on men who were the combatants in both of these insurgencies, right, of a radical crisis of what I'm going to call precarity, precariousness, of radical insecurity. The intersection of that with a crisis of systems of authority. What I want to suggest is, in fact, that virtually all of the systems of authority, government, civic, religious, corporate, were in fact in various states of collapse and were perceived by young men in particular as largely illegitimate and institutions from which they were both alienated and excluded. So you see the argument I'm trying to make here then. I'm saying if you inhabit that world of not just poverty, of not just a radical structural unemployment, but a world in which all of the institutional forms of authority are perceived to have excluded you and in ethico-moral terms are illegitimate, that's a very rich soil in which the politics of resentment can fester. That's the argument that I want to make. And I want to say to that degree, that intersection of a youth crisis of precarity with crises of authority, those are the properties that I want to say inhere in things called frontiers. I want to use frontiers in a particular type of way. For those of you who are Americanists or are American, of course, the frontier has a specific resonance. It's associated with Frederick Turner's great thesis about westward expansion, right, in which settlers, in the context of early state building, right, in some sense, expanded, settled, and produced particular types of identity, which for Turner, incidentally, was the rugged individualism of American capitalism. He wrote out of his story, incidentally, the genocidal impulses and consequences of that. But that's not what I mean by frontiers. Forget that for a moment. Park that. That's what I mean by frontiers. I'm saying there are times in all manner of states, not just early state building, but in contemporary states, in the post-colonial world and in the contemporary world, in which certain regions stand at the limits of central power. It's likely that a great deal of, in other words, if you just read that for a second, it's precisely frontiers are places where authority is being contested, is in question, in which the rule of law is unevenly present or elastic. So what I'm trying to make the argument then is these are particular frontier spaces, the Northeast and the Southeast. And these frontiers were marked by the relative collapse of authority. Virtually all systems of authority, not just government, but customary. And when I use the word customary, bear in mind that in Nigeria, as in much of sub-Saharan Africa, there is the coexistence of two different types of political authority: modern government and what is usually called customary or traditional authority. Chieftainship being obviously one. In the north of Nigeria, the remnants of the old pre-colonial caliphate, the emirate system, is another. These customary systems then of authority were also in collapse. So my title then is to suggest that these frontiers were, in a sense, a world in which young men in particular inhabited a world, apropos my title, without legitimate authority. They were populated by a generation of youth who felt these conditions acutely, the crumbling and effectiveness of institutions as much as their own economic and material poverty and insecurity. Contempt became their ruling ideology. It was, in short, a world of political and economics and spiritual insecurity. And here I'm going to draw upon my colleague Judith Butler to try to work with that. For someone of my generation who was influenced by punk music, I want to invoke the unimpeachable authority of the band The Sex Pistols and their wonderful song, remember that, No Future? When there's no future, how can there be sin? We're the flowers in the dustbin. We're the poison in your machine. Now, there's certain, that type of nihilism I'm suggesting, I'm not making light of that. I'm saying that if you inhabit a world of that material insecurity and poverty, of a world in which the institutions of which you're part show up as radically illegitimate, from which you are expelled, that's, again, an environment in some sense that's going to surely generate certain types of politics. Okay, now, to that extent, of course, I'm not suggesting that just because young men exist in those situations, that therefore they're automatically going to pick up an AK-47. To look at why these conditions produce particular types of radical Islamism in the north and a secular movement in the south, you have to look into the details, the cultural, historical, local details of those frontier spaces, and I'm going to try to give you a bit of a flavor of those sorts of things. Okay? But again, my task here tonight is to say, well, how did we end up in Nigeria, oil-rich Nigeria, and especially after 1999, with this enormous optimism of a return to civilian rule, how did we end up in a situation in which we have those overlapping and multiple crises of authority coupled with that radical economic and material precarity of a generation of young men? That's what I want to try to explain. I'm saying that's an important set of preconditions for understanding why these insurgencies arose. All right, then I'm going to do two things. I'm going to try to suggest why. I'm going to give this talk a German inflection, since I assumed Nicolazzi notwithstanding and the fire notwithstanding, there would be some German people here. I'm going to actually give some theoretical reference points Some of you might recognize these guys. Hannah Arendt, of course, Max Sebold, Ernst Bloch, and the old guy, you know. I'm sorry that many of these, the majority, are dead white men. I realize this is a major problem, but I will nonetheless think that I want to actually suggest that there, that these, this quartet of theoreticians, if you like, have something to say here. And then, inevitably, I want to conclude, of course, with the question that maybe, just maybe, Thomas gestured to this, there's something about my story in Nigeria that might actually speak to the contemporary landscape of American politics. And in fact, I want to suggest that, to paraphrase Brecht, the irresistible rise of Donald Trump is very much a story about generation, class, precarity, and the perceived crises of systems of authority. Okay. There you go. Okay, so I don't want to speak, I'll speak for about 25, 30 minutes, no more than that. We're running a little bit late anyway, so I'll try to cut it down. But let me begin with a little background then on each of these insurgencies, some I suggest you're familiar with, but the details matter. Let's begin, of course, with Boko Haram. You'll be familiar with them because they blew onto the front pages of the newspaper in 2014 with the abduction of 300 schoolgirls from Chibok. But actually, the movement dates back to radical prayer groups in the northeast of the country in the 1990s. It is a movement which has a Salafist or neo-Salafist orientation. Its rise was associated with a charismatic and very well-connected preacher, Muhammad Yusuf, who, incidentally, was murdered in police custody. His ideas were part of a wide-ranging debate, not peculiar to Nigeria, within the Nigerian Muslim Ummah, the Muslim community, over Muslim identity, what constituted legitimate Muslim practice, and what on earth, in a multi-ethnic federal system, could the adoption of Sharia law mean? You clear? This was a big debate of which he was, in some sense, a part. Boko Haram is often translated as Western education is a sin or forbidden. That's not how Boko Haram self-identify. They refer to themselves as people in support of the propagation of the prophet and jihadist ideas. And Yan Boko really means sons of, means of which they are very critical, is really a critique of secularism. And whilst it's absolutely true that Boko Haram, when it began, was critical and unaccepting of Christian communities, etc., etc., actually they targeted Muslim leaders who they felt were heretical. They targeted politicians who they felt were critical of them, etc., etc. Boko Haram has laid waste to much of the northeast of the country. According to the Council on Foreign Relations, 20,000 people were killed between 2000 and 2014, mostly Muslims, incidentally. 6,000 in 2015 alone. And at a certain point, particularly after 2019, it's clear there was a radical change in this movement from being essentially a local movement concerned with a series of local issues having to do with their desire to build a type of utopian community. But they had all sorts of run-ins with state and other insecurity forces. And in fact, the movement was drawn into electoral politics in that part of Nigeria, where in fact they were used for political purposes during a gubernatorial race, which they were promised various sorts of things, which they then, the politicians, reneged on. All of which is to say that at a certain point, and it's clear that this is related to connections between Boko Haram and other global jihadist movements, it's quite clear that the tactics changed, large-scale abductions, female suicide bombers, assassinations, beheadings, the brutal terrorism that we begin to see as tools of their trade. 2.5 million people had been displaced by April 16th. 1 million were in refugee camps around Maiduguri, the capital city. According to new estimates by the UN, almost 5 million people in the region are now facing starvation, gives you a sense then of what was essentially a local movement until 2009 when Mohammed Yusuf was murdered, and then the extraordinary expansion of activities. These are just a couple of shots then of the refugee camps that are currently exist. A word about MEND then. MEND emerged in the oil fields of the Niger Delta in 2005. Both of these movements then emerged as insurgencies in the middle of the 2000s, almost coevally. This was an area, the oil fields, was an area prior to 2005 in which there were all manner of political conflicts on the oil fields. Communities that were angry at the practices of US corporations that had despoiled the environment. Often conflicts between and among oil-producing communities on the oil fields who were struggling to get access to the oil companies in terms of oil rents. In 2005, they emerged. They promised to close down the oil industry. And in 3 months, in 2006, through a series of very audacious attacks, they did just that. Between 2006 and 2009, there were 300 armed assaults, 13,000 pipeline attacks. Just like Boko Haram, these fragmented conflicts across the Delta were drawn together by a charismatic leader, a person called Tom Polo from the west of the Niger Delta. Just to give you a sense of these red dots represent the various attacks that were made over this particular time period. So, I could talk more about those things. Let me just say, obviously, once again, that both of these represent major crises of legitimacy for Nigeria's post-colonial state. And this was stunningly underscored, as I mentioned, by those two attacks in 2010 and 11, when attacks were launched in the heart of the capital city. One in the UN compound, the other during the October Independence Day celebrations. Okay. Now, I want to suggest a couple of things here. That obviously, these movements on their face are a complete study in contrast. One is draped in the language of the ideals of Dar es Salaam, of true Islam, of the restoration of the caliphate, Sharia law, and so on. The other is completely secular. It was a movement devoted to renovated civic nationalism, talking about a new type of federalism, which would permit greater wealth to be allocated to the oil fields, which they felt they had lost because of the nationalization of mineral rights. One occurred in the dry northeast on the savannas, the other in the tropical rainforests of the southeast. One, the north, is an area marked by agrarian recession and the collapse of the traditional textile industry. The other is the center of oil production, in which some of the largest transnational companies in the world are present. And not least, there are interesting contrasts in terms of poverty. These are both regions that are poor, but the Northeast in particular is the poorest in the Federation. 86%, according to the World Bank, in the Northeast are absolutely poor. So on the one hand then, along virtually any axis of comparison, Boko Haram and MEND seem as though they don't have very much in common. On the other hand, it seems to me, there's something paradoxical about these sorts of movements. The paradox is simply this, that on the one hand, both of them emerged after a return to some type of functioning multi-party democracy. One. Two, they also emerged at times in which, in both regions, you could plausibly make the argument that things were getting better. How? In the north, after 2000, Sharia law had been adopted across those 12 northern states. In other words, one of the basic planks of Boko Haram had seemingly been achieved. By the same token, in the southeast, after 1999, because of a change in the calculi by which oil revenues, and bear in mind, 80% of all of the state's revenues in Nigeria are derived from oil and gas. Because of a change in the calculi by which those revenues were allocated through a principle that was called derivation. Derivation simply meant that if you had a resource in your jurisdiction, you got a proportion of those returns. What that meant was that the oil fields after 1999 were awash in money. So there's a paradox here. Both of these arose, one might argue, at times when in certain respects, it looked as if things were getting better. So there's some interesting sorts of conundra here that have to be explained. Okay, so what I want to do then is now to spend 15 minutes or so, and I'd like to try to lay out for you how I think these conditions, which are central to me to the emergence of these insurgencies, the youth crisis and institutional illegitimacy, arose. Before I do that, I just want to mention one thing. When I use this word youth, right, this has a specific set of meanings in Nigeria and in much of sub-Saharan Africa. When I'm using youth, I'm invoking, on the one hand, the great work of Karl Mannheim, who talked about generational politics. I mean, we take this for granted now, right? I'm a 60s type of guy. Charles is a millennial. But Mannheim was acutely aware then of the fact that certain particular historical experiences experienced by certain age cohorts could be foundational in their worldview. That's a part of what I'm talking about. But youth also refers to something else in much of sub-Saharan Africa, which is that because of the existence of customary institutions, clans and lineages and so on, and chieftainship, they are often gerontocratic in character. There are sharp distinctions between children, youth, which is a liminal and a transitional category between being a child and becoming an adult. And obviously elders have specific sorts of culturally induced powers. So when I refer to youth then in this particular way, it's in both of those respects. That, and there are all sorts of organizations across West Africa in which, depending on your age and depending on when you were born, there are all sorts of cultural and other organizations of which you're part. So you'll see the significance of that when I come back and talk about it in detail. Okay, so in a nutshell then, let me start with the question of how can we get to this conundrum of a youth crisis and institutional illegitimacy. Well, Nigeria is typically seen as the worst case of what is often called a resource curse. 80% of Nigeria's government revenues, 95% of its export revenues, and somewhere between 15%, sometimes up to 40%, depending on oil prices, of gross domestic product comes from one commodity, oil. The argument here of the resource curse is that why is it so often the case, not only in Nigeria, but in resource-dependent, oil-producing petro-states in general, this tends to go with all sorts of failures. State deficits, state dysfunctions, corruption, patrimonialism, and even poor economic growth, or economic growth rather more less impressive than one would have expected. We had Joe Stiglitz in this room speaking a few weeks ago. He's a major theoretician of exactly that theory. Paul Collier at Oxford is another. Jeffrey Sachs at Columbia. They've all tried to make this type of argument. And the argument, in some sense, then, says that, well, at a certain point in history, when oil becomes is discovered and becomes commercially available, it is inserted into an existing political economy. A multi-ethnic federal system in Nigeria. Most oil came online almost exactly at independence in 1960. And that oil is then captured by the state. And typically, whether it's Saudi Arabia, Venezuela, they all do it the same way. You set up a national oil company, you nationalize all subsurface mineral rights, you have a whole raft of laws which simply set up statutory monopolies. And that permits you to, one, set up a national oil company, go into arrangements with the transnational oil companies, Chevron, BP, you have a memorandum of understanding, and you either through joint ventures or what are called production share agreements, you basically divide, you come up with an arrangement by which you divide the value of every single barrel of oil, whether it's selling at 150 a barrel or 20. So what that means then is that the state captures all of those oil revenues. And what that produced then was a in other words, what's the metaphor? The goose that lays the golden egg, right? Sitting at the heart of the state is a shitload of money. And depending on the political economy into which it's inserted, that produces a ferocious series of political struggles to get access to it by fair means or foul. Sometimes that's referred to as patrimonialism, neo-patrimonialism. Sometimes it's just offhandedly referred to as grand corruption. The great Nigerian novelist Chinua Achebe said, Nigerian government is, quote, like a big, crappy family, unquote. What he was referring to there was the extent to which certain well-connected business, military, political classes were able, in fact, a type of elite cartel, were able... Okay, that's the type of resource-cursed argument. And the argument is that it produces... There's been perhaps $1 trillion of oil and gas earnings, $1 trillion since 1960. And this hasn't translated into significant increases in employment or necessarily striking improvements in well-being and life chances. Wage employment is still low and falling, actually, only about 12%. Youth unemployment is, official statistics say, 40. In these two regions, it's close to 70%. Between 1980 and 2000, the share of the population subsisting on less than a dollar grew from 36 to 70%. The best way to think about it is this. This is the International Monetary Fund. I don't think they're necessarily prone to exaggeration, necessarily, or they're not necessarily a bunch of young Trotskyists. Oil did not seem to add to the standard of living, it could have contributed to the decline of standard of living. Well, in my language, that's a crisis of secular national development. Okay. Now, that's what the resource curse is purporting to explain. Now, there's a profound truth in this, but I would immediately want to qualify by saying, wait a second, it is also true that in Nigeria, since the Civil War and since oil's discovery, they have also built a durable federal system. After all, Nigeria has not fallen back into civil war after the devastating consequences of the Biafran Civil War between 1967 and 1970. Secondly, they have some type of multi-party democracy in place. And important sorts of institution building has happened. Increasing separation of powers, more autonomy for the judiciary, gradual improvement in the electoral process, and so on and so forth. In other words, then, rather than just simply seeing the resource curse, which has a certain truth to it, as a monochromatic account of Nigeria, the fact of the matter is, of course, it's much more complicated than that. And as you can appreciate, in any complex federal system, there are some parts of that federal system and some states where state capacity and the public sector and things work rather well, and other parts of that federal system that don't. Sure, that's as true in the United States as it is in Nigeria. Well, Mississippi, it's a little funky down there. Oh, California, well, we have Schwarzenegger, but we're still... You see what I'm saying? And exactly the same way in Nigeria, Lagos, just to take two, Lagos and Edo states, in my book, have been rather well managed. Parts of the Northeast and Southeast that I'm talking about, absolutely not. So what I want to suggest to you then is that whilst we have to be sensitive to this resource curse dynamics, let's not assume that everything is bad. I'm trying to say, well, why is it that things were, in spite of these dynamics, particularly problematic in these areas that I'm calling frontier zones in the Northeast and Southeast? That's not a condemnation of Nigeria as a whole. Okay, so what I want to suggest then is a rather different way of thinking about this, which goes something like this. And here I'm going to pull upon the work of a guy called Dan Slater, a political scientist in Chicago. He says the following. He's writing about Southeast Asia. He says, look, Southeast Asia in the post-colonial period saw the emergence of what he called authoritarian leviathans. He said these emerged, they were not necessarily warm and cuddly places, but he said these regimes arose because of very contentious class politics. Class politics, he said, that were endemic and unmanageable. That's to say they were a threat to powerful forces, urban insurrections, etc., etc., often shaped by left movements. These threats, he says, sustained state-centered coalitions and pacts, which facilitated state building, often through coercive apparatuses, but more generally by building durable institutions. And he calls these protection pacts. He says they may not be warm and cuddly, but actually they were quite effective coalitions of among state officials, economic elites, middle classes, communal elites, who, he says, quote, shared support for heightened state power and tightened authoritarian controls. This protection pact involved forms of extraction, flows of resources, especially direct taxation, that convinced powerful social forces that they had more to fear from each other than from the state. Now, something like this, even though you might have thought that it would emerge in the context of falling into civil war in 1967, surely an endemic and unmanageable problem, did not happen. And rather, what happened was the rise of oil and that pot of gold being located at the center of the state. And what Slater says, when you have something like that, what you have is not a protection pact, but a provisioning pact. And what a provisioning pact does is, in fact, it doesn't have to bother about state building and direct taxation and building durable institutions. You can, under some circumstances, use that pot of gold to purchase consent. You buy off consent. You shovel that money through what in Nigeria is called fiscal federalism, the allocation, a complicated allocation system to government, to state governments, local governments, how you issue contracts and tenders and import licenses. That becomes a vehicle for keeping a very contentious, multi-ethnic, fractious Nigeria together. Is that clear? It's a provisioning pact, different logic. So, what does that mean then in practice? It means a couple of things. It means that, in fact, Nigeria had this double movement, capturing oil monies, which involves centralizing power, and then dispersing those revenues through a set of institutional mechanisms. That's called the revenue mobilization and allocation process. I'm not going to walk you through all the details of it, but virtually every oil state has some version of that. Statutory monopolies, you capture the rents, that centralizes power, and then mechanisms to irrigate and distribute through the provisioning system. Of course, what it can produce at one level, then, is a system in which it's not transparent, it's not terribly accountable, it's extremely leaky, and functionally that system is distributing oil revenues and not needing to depend on other systems of revenue generation, let's say through taxation, in order to purchase a particular type of consent. That produces, you know, That's one reason why the issue of corruption has been a central issue for Nigerian leadership throughout the post-colonial period. We can argue about whether it's got better or worse or what's been done about it, but that's a fact. The World Bank thinks that, according to their estimates, $500 billion of that trillion are simply, to use their language, missing. Okay? Head of the EFCC, the Economic Financial Crimes Commission, Mr. Rabado, a good friend of mine, said that the functioning of government was what he called organized theft. Now, my point is, Nigeria doesn't have a monopoly on corruption. My goodness, that's not my argument. I'm saying that we need to think about corruption in the context of this provisioning pact and who, in fact, is getting access to those spoils. It's a type of spoils politics. Max Weber, if you remember, had a wonderful term for the degree to which public office can become a vehicle for private appropriation. He called that a prebend. prebendalization, if you want to use that language, is central to the operations of this type of provisioning system. Now, what's the point of me walking through all of that? Well, I want to make two claims. One is that it did, in fact, produce a type of stability. There hasn't been another civil war. I mean, I'm talking about insurgencies. But in this fractious, imagine, 2 million people died in the Biafran War. It has functioned to a certain type of stability, one. But two, the provisioning pact has what I would call built-in birth defects. Why? Well, because the value of your resource that's basic to the provisioning pact, the price of oil, it could crash. The nature of corruption or the state deficits, if you have a system in which state institutions are really vehicles for either personal or communal or political accumulation, then it stands to reason that these institutions aren't going to be terribly effective at delivering education, delivering anything. The second birth defect, then, is before you know it, you've got a system that's sort of radically dysfunctional. Okay. Nigeria has a wonderful language for that dysfunction, particularly in the public sector. There are terms like government involves carry go or chop fine. These are all ways in which the popular classes talk about what they perceive as what exactly transpires in the name of the public sector. Now, what's the significance of this? Well, the first is then that this provisioning pact can have three big consequences for the insurgency. One is that the public sector can become a blockage to accumulation. There are so many popular jokes, there is so much critique of NEPA, it's now been renamed, was the state provider of electricity. Let's just say that it didn't work. I think you get my point here, right? But state institutions can be sufficiently dysfunctional such that it's a blockage to capital accumulation. This can happen in all sorts of ways that I won't bother you with, but I think you can see from what I've said. Secondly, the second thing that happens is, of course, that this type of... second point is that the provisioning pact produced a particular type of what I've called spatial fragmentation. Imagine a system in which you have a pot of money, in which politics is about organizing communities, most of which are ethnic, in order to get access to those centralized oil monies. And those centralized oil revenues are distributed through a fiscal federal system, which lays out that states, the federal center retains this much money, the states get this much money, and the local government get this much money. Can you not imagine that the political logic in that system is there are a set of incentives to precisely make claims for your own state? Is that clear? Or your own local government. Only in this way can you explain why in 1965 there were four states, there are currently 336, there were 50 local governments, there are currently 774. And the claims to create new states and local governments because it provides you with a constitutional vehicle to get access, by fair means or foul, to the allocation process. And what I'm saying is that that produces a type of spatial fissioning, a parcelizing of sovereignty, if you like. And I'm struck by the fact that the great Nigerian leader, Awolowo, once said at independence that Nigeria wasn't a nation, it was a mere geographical expression. What I'm saying, in a sense, oil has made that even more so. What you have is a type of fragmentation in which the idea of a nation, of course, still exists, but it becomes very rocky because the identities that matter are less than the identities, often ethnic, often communal, often religious, that can be the basis for getting access to the state monies. And last but not least, then, is in fact the problem of what this means for the legitimacy of institutions. And I want to suggest three or four ways, just very briefly then, in which this translates into this institutional problem. First, as I've said, that government is often perceived to be not just non-functional, but in fact is deeply corrupt. Electoral fraud, the inability of public good provisions, etc., etc. Right. That I showed this picture because one of the constant themes, particularly in these insurgent areas, is the degree to which state security forces are seen to be corrupt, violent, and undisciplined. So one aspect then is that how the provisioning pact produces sets of institutions at the federal level that are seen to be in some sense illegitimate. Secondly, this is also the case for customary institutions. Chieftainship. I just want to give you one little illustration from the Niger Delta. Chiefs who preside over villages and over territories as customary rulers, if you have some type of presence of oil infrastructure or an oil well in your territory, you have a claim from the company on some type of compensation. That typically goes to community development, but invariably it gets pocketed. And that produces, among other things, ferocious battles among ruling families to become chief, to become paramount chief. And this, of course, then produces internal resentments within the community. Youth groups, in particular, say, well, wait a second. This guy's pocketing all this dough. Why is it that suddenly the elders' councils that previously had five people on them now have 25 people on them, and they're all getting... And, of course, then it's not surprising, right, that youth groups say, well, let's either get rid of this guy, or why not go around the chief and go directly to the oil company and say, Alex, you got pipelines here. You know, they can be blown up. You extort. Well, if one group then it can extort, why doesn't another youth group try to do this? So you can see where I'm going with this then. That this system of customary rule can begin to unravel very quickly and can be seen to be... The first time I went into this guy's community, Nembe, I went in by boat. There were young men there, unbelievably angry, carrying AK-47s, and this guy had been turfed out. They occupied his compound. They said, he's totally corrupt, and now we're going to become the representative of the community. They called it happened in February, they called it the February Revolution. They were called themselves the Small Minnows. And they were negotiating now directly with the oil company. So, but you see where I'm going with this. Customary institutions can also begin to be challenged in that same type of way. Thirdly, religious authority. Just very briefly, I mentioned that Boko Haram itself is precisely the product of internal debates. The leader of Boko Haram precisely says that the prevailing powerful Sufi brotherhoods and or the modernizing Muslim parties, in some sense, do not practice true Islam. So often there can be then a whole debate within religious communities over what is and is not appropriate institutional and religious practice. Same goes for civic institutions. A huge effloration of non-government groups, but they're often seen as being feeding at the same trough. They're just become vehicles in the name of setting up a non-profit group to work on environmental restoration, of just getting access to these same oil funds. And last but not least, you have, particularly in the Delta, questions of corporate illegitimacy. Again, I won't go into this in any detail, but simply to say that, of course, if I tell you that disaster, Exxon Valdez, or that disaster in the Gulf of Mexico, right? One of those happened, an equivalent of that happens every year in the Niger Delta. That is to say then that what we're seeing here is a record of oil spills and corporate irresponsibility and all sorts of conflicts emerging out of this guy. You can begin to see, obviously, all sorts of conflicts in and around. And the oil companies themselves have a way of talking about this. Can I just give you an example of this? I talked to a guy. It was in Shell, actually. And I, and this was back in 2001. He said, "Well, you know, Shell, we in Shell, we have $250 million, which we pay in cash payments." He said, "This is off the books." He said, "These are payments that we make to basically anyone that we need to make payments to in order to keep the oil flowing. Alex's youth group, the chief. Doesn't make any difference. To one oil company." Right? And what emerged, of course, were all of these conflicts in which they now refer to them, the oil company has this language, they don't have a social license to operate. That's how they describe it. That's a, for me, that's a corporate authority legitimation crisis. Okay? So you can begin to see where I'm going with this then. Just to, I'm going to finish in just 2 minutes here. Which is that obviously, if you inhabit that world as a youth, if you inhabit the world of multiple and overlapping and nested systems of authority, right, all of which you perceive to be and are for you functionally illegitimate, then you're living in some way outside of or a life without authority. And I'm saying that when that is, that what that produces then is a class of individuals of massively constricted possibility. Right? As I've said, contempt is their ruling ideology. Right? Youth becomes, in fact, not a transitional status, but a permanent status. Sometimes this has been referred to youth as occupying, of becoming a socially extended category. There's no obvious way out of it. As a young man, you can't see a way to getting out of that status of youth, which involves getting married, building a household, etc., etc. It's that radical economic, systematic unemployment, and so on. And this could be rural, it could be urban, you could be an unemployed university graduate. Both of these movements are cross-class in their character. They are a wageless class of various sorts of educational accomplishment. But the point is then that what this means in practice is that these, this precarious existence of young men who are, as it were, surrounded by decaying forms of institutional order. They're not only excluded from the market order, unemployment, but in fact they're excluded from and alienated from and reject these crumbling forms of customary corporate state and institutional power and authority. That seems to me a defining quality, and it produces, on the one hand, a culture of suspicion and cynicism and rejection, but that reservoir of anger is incredibly deep. It's what a colleague of mine who's describing Central Africa refers to as the existence of a class of masterless men. And what that, to me, speaks to is simply this, that these precarious conditions in these frontier areas provide a powerful thread linking youth militancy to a series of political orders that denies them recognized forms of authority. And there are two things that I want to suggest, is that one, that can take the form of what I would call a crisis of masculinity. If you can't get married, if you can't get out of this status of youth, if you can't build a household, if your possibilities of upward mobility are radically truncated, then what it means to be male and masculine is in some sense questioned. And the second thing is, again, if you inhabit that world long enough, then it seems to be, and that's why I quote this slide here, is there's a type of rejectionist or a maybe even nihilistic ideology that emerges from it. These are the two movements, radically different in all sorts of ways. But look at what they say. So that seems to me to be a central ideological part of all of this. So listen, let me just wrap up here then. These, it seems to me, is that at the heart of the insurgency is a crisis of social reproduction of a generation of young men, of very different cultural identities in the two areas, who are suspect of institutions of authority which they lack, for which they lack credibility and functional adequacy and certainly legitimacy. Central to each of these experiences of young men, then, are these multiple and overlapping crises of authority, coupled with this type of material and economic insecurity. All right, so again, let me just say that none of this per se explains the rise of these movements, but it's interesting to me that just from the sketch that I gave, it's interesting that both of these movements have certain, in spite of their obvious differences, have interesting similarities. They both had charismatic leaders, which held together these fragmented communities. Their composition of the combatants were cross-class. They're obviously, they drew strength from, I haven't had time to talk about this, but one of the common features to both of these insurgencies were that they were at various times repressed by state military forces, which were seen to be corrupt and violent. I mentioned the killing of the leader of Boko Haram. So on the one hand, then, they were triggered by state repression. And on the other hand, each of them at certain points actually received support from the state. These movements actually were used as political thugs during the electoral cycle. And in some cases, in the Delta in particular, were actually armed by politicians. Both of those things, then, are again are part of this operations of this provisioning pact. And interestingly, finally, both of their leaders, coming back to this question of the crisis of masculinity, both of these leaders talked directly and acted upon the need to get resources to young men in order for them to get married and build households. It wasn't just an abstraction. So that's sort of what I have to say. Let me then... I said I would give you the Germanic, let me just jump over these, the Germanic conclusion. All right, I'll be done in 1 minute, I promise. So, does this resonate in any way? How do we think about this theoretically? Hannah Arendt. Arendt, of course, in the wake of the Second World War, was deeply concerned with the millions of stateless refugees without the rights to have rights. Esra talked about this in her talk. This exclusion from legal protection prompted refugees to seek life as she saw it in a state of lawlessness and abjection. Her charge was to warn that what can happen when, as she put it, people are rendered superfluous, or to put it in my language, disposable. I think I've given you a story of disposability within a country that arose because of a series of political dynamics that have to do with the operations of the Provisioning Pact. You see that? That's Karl. Okay, Marx, in the 18th Brumaire. I just want to read you this. He's talking about a revolutionary situation, right? And he says that the new revolutionaries, the radicals, right, the insurgents, anxiously conjure up the spirits of the past to their service, borrowing from them names, battle slogans, and costumes in order to present this new scene in world history in time-honored guise and borrowed language. The point is what I think Marx is getting at here, and I didn't have time to talk this about in the case of Mend, but both of these movements look back to time-honored traditions. Jihad. Or in the case of Mend, I didn't mention this, but the leaders of these of the insurgency were adepts of what's called Egbesu. It's a war cult that goes back, has a long history among Ijaw peoples, going back to anti-colonial struggles and so on. So, in a sense, then, I think Marx is right here. He's in both of these movements, there's something of that Brumarian sort. You can't see, this is Ernst Bloch. Bloch, in a wonderful essay in 1932, talked about how people that reside in different types of economies but live in the same now can suffer, can be shaped by the ways in which one system is disappearing and the other is emerging. He referred to this as the synchronicity of differing histories residing in the same present. And he said, don't forget, he was talking about Weimar. And Bloch said that when that is happening, living in the same now, but that what that produces, he says, let me quote, is a beautiful, a warm and moist humus for ideology. I think what I've given you are some examples of a very warm and moist humus ideology. Last, my favorite novelist of all time, Max Sebald, we could talk about this forever. But look, whatever else this marvelous, marvelous novelist wrote about, it was always about people who were in exile, traumatized, at the margins, alienated and outcast. Those in exiles from some sort of heimat, but exiled from institutions of authority. We're, as he put it, haunted by ghosts of the past, which we must confront and from which we cannot possibly escape. All right, last but not least then, Trump. Let me start here. I'm sorry, this is the last minute. This guy is a jazz musician who I like a lot. I saw him just before I left. Wonderful guy. In an interview in the New York Times, he was raised in Compton in LA, not so far from where Daniel is. And he said this. He was talking in the context of Black Lives Matter, extraordinary police violence against young black men, the fantastic incarceration rates. Okay. The harsh reality in our community is that greatest representatives of order are basically against you. You feel as if you lived without. Surely what he's posing here is, what's it like as a young black man to live in a world in which institutions of order show up as disorder? It's exactly what he was talking about, it seems to me. And that's sort of what I've been describing. Now, I'm not for a moment suggesting that therefore you can conflate what's been happening in Maiduguri or the Niger Delta or northeast Nigeria with Compton. But my point is to take seriously then, again, the lived world in which systems of authority show up as illegitimate, forces of order as disorder. And to that extent, this organization that I've worked for years, the Social Science Research Council, just produced a wonderful report on exactly what they have a different language. They didn't talk about the youth crisis. They talk about youth disconnection in inner cities among communities of color. And their point is they're unhinged, they're expelled from, and therefore in a world outside of virtually all forms of institutional authority, from the family to the state. It's an incredible report. Okay, so what does this mean then? Seems to me that I'm suggesting that not that young people in the United States are likely to turn to armed rebellion. Neither am I suggesting that young men and women are fleeing to Trump by virtue of their alienation from institutions or disconnectedness. Actually, quite the reverse. Right? What I'm talking about is America's version of generational politics. Forms of alienation from the market order and from forms of authority, especially political institutions, that among Trump supporters as seen as completely illegitimate. I think Trump's irresistible rise, then, is one expression of America's sort of the crisis of social reproduction, with its own distinctive generational and class and racialized sort. This is, then, his support base clearly are of older white guys, white men and women in particular, who precisely stand in the similar relationship to these systems of authority that I talked about. He's an authoritarian, racist capitalist speaking the language of organic nationalism, renewal, and purity. And look, I don't throw around the word fascism lightly. I don't think we should ever do that because we could say, well, actually, Trump is an authoritarian populist. But Robert Paxton, who has written for me some of the best work on fascism and what it means, take this definition here. And it seems to me that there's something here which, there are some exceptions in relationship to what Trump is doing or could do. I'm simply posing for you then that maybe there's a way in which we can take from that Nigeria story about systems of authority, systems of illegitimacy, expulsion from the market order, right? And see then in that type of generational politics, something that sort of resonates on the contemporary landscape of American politics. Thank you very much. Sorry we've gone on for so long. I know it's late and so on, but if anyone has some questions and have the stamina before they get to the appeal of pumpkin pie, which I quite understand, you should move on as quickly as you can. I'd be happy to hear your comments or reflections. Yes. Rebecca.
First of all, thank you very much for a very sophisticated, layered talk, and I think I got it. I do have a question. At some point, you talked about youth groups, and yet you never told us how people organized or whether or not these groups are functioning. I also would like to hear a little bit more about the decay of the family, because it's implicit that that's not working, but why is that? I don't know if those things are connected.
Just, maybe the best thing I can do is give a couple of examples, right, on youth groups. Let's just take the Niger Delta example that I gave. And I gave you the example of a chief in an oil-producing community who's receiving oil payments for community development. They get squirreled away, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Okay. Now, in that community, it's a type of lineage or clan system based by age cohort. So you are born at a certain time and inserted into an age cohort. And you move through, and there are ritual and cultural expectations, including work groups and various types of obligations in the community that you have. And whilst it's never easy to determine when youth begins and when ends, there are all manner of cultural organizations, right, which have long existed that get repurposed in the context of the tensions within this particular system. In other words, then, that an existing cultural group in a particular community, then, which know one another, have worked together, et cetera, et cetera, they they are typically named, they have a name, et cetera, then get repurposed or then take on certain political functions. And that political function, incidentally, historically, could have been as fulfilling these are martial societies, fulfilling military purposes with respect to conflict with other local communities. Now they're being repurposed and they've become a group that simply provides the basis for either critiquing or making claims on a chief, or they just become an aggregate of people who collectively can simply say, we can extort money from the oil company. So these youth groups, and they vary obviously depending on what ethnic group, the details you have to explore ethnographically, right? But that's essentially what I'm talking about. Youth, it's a type of social status that will take different cultural forms among different sorts of communities that have long-standing forms of organization with obligations and responsibilities that under a certain set of circumstances, corrupt chiefs, can access to oil monies, can be repurposed for other ends. And a UN report, for example, in 2005 estimated that there were 150 conflicts across the Delta, which involved groups of this sort. And often some of them took on a type of political character. They named themselves the 1895 Liberation Brigade. 1895 was an important battle against the colonialists. Right? So they often took on not just a cultural youth organ, but they took on a type of political form. But they were fragmented and dispersed and not coordinated. What that MEND movement did and what that charismatic leader did, which I didn't really make clear, was that he had, by virtue of his charismatic and other abilities, was able to draw together these threads of these groups, some of which, frankly, were not really political and were, you'd have to say, criminal organizations. They look to me rather like mafias. If any of you followed the origins of the mafias in Western Sicily in the middle of the 19th century, you know that mafias arose in the context of class conflicts in a situation in which the state, the post-resurgimento Italian state, could not exercise its monopoly of means of violence. It was a frontier. And therefore, the mafia arose then as providing protection services. Well, there's something like that going on here. But what we see are... Wait, you see where I'm going with that type of argument? So lots of variants of that sort began to emerge, not only against chiefs, but often against other sorts of communities, for example. Often turning on questions of land. Right? If, in fact, your access to an oil company payment turns on where something is located, If this community says it's on our territory, but another community says, no, it isn't, and in a context in which there's a lot of juridical ambiguity over land rights, then that can be very combustible. So these are the types of movements, these are the types of conflicts that emerge for which youth, so-called youth groups, began. What I was saying was that as a form of generational politics, right, the possibility of moving beyond that status, which typically is about marriage, household formation, building a future, were extremely difficult. And that's why I said that it was a type of that youth status became a type of state of suspended animation, a type of permanency. Right? That if you inhabit that world, I think it's exactly this type of rich humus that I talked about. Now, and you mentioned then, just briefly, family structures and so on. Yes, I mean, the fact of the matter is, I collected a whole bunch of survey data on this sorts of things, of the degree to which, because marriages are everywhere, complicated things, and particularly when they involved all sorts of payments between families and between lineages in order to get married, etc., then what we see is the rise of generations of people. You know, in a way, Rebecca, you know, it's not terribly unlike the degree to which university graduates in the United States currently live at home. Have you seen the figures on this? Staggering. Well, what's that about? That's a statement about, we don't have a culture of youth politics, but it's a statement about the ability to get your life going as a young man, woman, university graduate even. So what I was able to show in this survey data was the degree to which it's just simply impossible, given the culturally expected standards and norms of what it takes in order to engage in marriage negotiations, marriage payments, etc., etc. It's impossible. And this was precisely what these leaders talked about. The need to, and they provided resources to do that. So it was, that's really not so much only a, it is a type of argument about familial decomposition, but more than anything, it's about the likelihood among certain generations of being able to establish a family, to break from one's family. And you see what I'm saying? That's I know it's late. I know the licorice and pumpkin is calling. Yes, please. Thank you. Very good. Thanks.
Yeah. Thank you, Prof, for that good lecture. So many things have been said. Actually, there's nothing to debate about the facts that you presented. But given the short time, I know you probably would have touched more on other areas.
Yeah.
For instance, you identified a problem. But I think we also need to talk about the solution, which the time may not have allowed you to do. Mm. Then somewhere along the line too, I think maybe you could have also made a projection, given the situation as it is. Mm. What do we think of tomorrow? Where is Nigeria heading? Right. So that's another issue. Yeah. Then I thought maybe you could have also talked about the role of land ownership, land holding, especially in the Delta. Mm. Because the criminality, in quotes, in the Delta, it wasn't there a few years ago when there was a prosperity in terms of fishing, in terms of farming and things. So, but when prospecting for oil destroy the environment of the people and take away their livelihood, that the people will have to engage themselves somehow. And that is why they have to resort to all these kind of things they are doing, knowing that oil companies are also contributing to what their deprivation. Right. So they have to take what the oil company is taking away from them, from the oil companies themselves, and invariably from the government, because the oil companies are prospective for the government. Right. So when people look at it without a proper understanding, you will think that what is happening in the Delta is criminality. It is absolutely the last, I don't know how to say, the last thing you can hold up to for survivor. Okay.
Okay, let me address two issues there. Just to be clear, I hope I am not suggesting in any way that, just to take the Niger Delta part of the story, that that firstly, a part of the crisis was the fact that the means of livelihood, partly as a result of the despoliation of the environment, which is primarily, in my view, in part about corporate irresponsibility, but also, if you have, under MEND auspices, 13,000 attacks on pipelines, this causes devastating consequences too. But you're right, a part of the insecurity that young men faced was precisely that the material and ecological basis of their forms of livelihood had been eviscerated. And your point about, therefore, of course there was a certain desperation, therefore, absolutely. But I wanted to make the argument that's an important part of the story. But if you leave out the story about institutions, legitimacy, authority, then you lose something very profound. And exactly the same way in the North, there it's not obviously a story about oil companies and despoliation. It's about something else. And that's a complicated story because on the one hand, I mentioned in the North, we've seen the collapse of the textile industry. That was the heart. Why the hell did that happen? Well, was it because of cheap Chinese imports? Yeah. But why the hell was Nigeria importing cheap Chinese imports? It was because import licenses were given to a bunch of influential people who made enormous profits from that cheap importation, which devastated the industry. That's one part of the story. The other part of the story, frankly, is something that we could call global climate change. It's devastated that part of the, that had big implications of livelihood. And let's not forget one other thing. I didn't have time to talk all of this thing. But look, that impoverished part of the Northeast, right, in addition to what I've just described, has average fertility rates of 7. Is that clear? Right? An average Northeastern woman in your reproductive lifetime, average, has 7 offspring. 65%, actually close to 70% of the population in the Northeast is less than 25 years. You not only have a youth crisis, you have a youth bulge. That means large numbers of people are constantly being fed into this youth cohort with absolutely no employment opportunities. Okay, so these, again, there are different dynamics, which if I'd had another 4 hours, I could have talked about. But you take my point. Let me just, one last thing on solutions. Yeah, right, I'm not a policy wonk. But look, the short answer to this is, well, if Michael, you're right, and it's a crisis of the legitimacy of institutions, let's just hold for a second the question of employment and so on, then the issue is build legitimate institutions. So where do we begin there? Well, again, I will just flag a couple of things, and you know this better than I do, right? Is that, first of all, there are parts of Nigeria which have done exactly that. I happen to think Governor Fashola in Lagos State, Lagos, who would have thought? I'm not suggesting it's a model of democracy, but they turned that state around by building durable institutions. Edo, Oshumole, same thing. Right, so first of all, there are models out there, but that's about politics. That's one. The second thing is, how do you start building, and where do you start building legitimate institutions when you have this pot of gold sitting at the heart of the state? Where on earth do you begin? Do you say, well, we'll get a smart guy like Mr. Ribadu, head of the economic and financial crisis, and we'll let him try to clean things up? Well, we know where that went. So, but on the other hand, if you know that lots of money trickles down through this fiscal federal system and it seems very leaky and it seems not very transparent, then one thing you can do is you can say, let's open up the budgetary process and let's develop institutions at the local level, the local government area, that can hold individuals accountable through contracting and tendering. And again, you know as well as I do that this is where civic institutions have played an important role. And again, there are some importantly creative things happening there. So again, I always get a question like this. It says, Michael, you must be a complete depressive because you've painted such a bleak picture. And the way that I've done it by focusing on insurgencies, I can understand that. But if you remember, I said that these are frontier areas which emerge in the context of other parts of the country that look very, very different. But I guess my point was to simply say, you know, if you defer for a very long time, not being prepared to address fundamental structural problems that young men face, and if you hope that by throwing a little money and trying to co-opt or buy off anger and resentment is the way, you will be in very deep trouble. But if you do that and you let that go, then what you find is people who inhabit this world, that the reservoir is of anger is so deep. I can't tell you. You know, I spent a lot of time in the Delta talking to these very angry young men. And that's about how you, if you let that go, if you defer long enough, then the process of beginning to build those institutions and draw young men and women back into institutions that they respect, that's going to be extremely tough. I don't have any answers to that any more than I have an answer at one level to the jazz musician who's saying the forces of police order show up as disorder. I mean, that's absolutely right, and that's going to require an enormous amount of work in order to write that. But there's already large generations of young black men who are rightly and properly extremely angry, are disconnected in all sorts of ways, and the process of reconnection is going to take a lot of work, not only from within the black community, but building up institutions of order, the police, in which all of us, and young people of color in particular, have some faith. And this will be if you don't mind, will be the last question. Is yes. that okay? It's because I can see people here are already waving their hands at me. Saying,
thank you very much for this excellent lecture. What you said is all quite true. But I want to find out from you, what is your perception of the present government's policy in terms of diversification? Vocational training.
You're going to get me arrested, Chief.
No.
I open this door, man. There's going to be some police.
No,
I know this one.
No.
This is the look.
First time we see you speechless.
There's an easy answer, and perhaps a trivial answer to this, which is to say that, you know, I think President Buhari was elected rightly and properly, and I believe, I don't know what your opinion is, relatively free and fair elections. I have not seen any reports which suggest anything that Good Luck Jonathan, the previous president, was anything but bounced out of office by significant majorities of people who were dissatisfied, in my view, rightly, with this performance. I think that, and he came in with, I think, even though he was a former military man, and I think some people had some questions about that, he had a history of taking on corruption and indiscipline, as you know. Okay. So I think there was a sense of, if not optimism, expectation. Now, he also then confronted two immediate crises. One was Boko Haram. That already existed. And I think he made the grave error, you remember this in December, of saying, well, as far as I'm concerned, Boko Haram is technically defeated. You remember that statement? And of course, 2 days later, there's a massive attack. So I think he has not come to terms yet with what the nature of that threat and what to do about it. That's one. The second thing that he confronted was, remember I said, built-in birth defects. Oil prices in 2008 were $150 a barrel. What are they now? 35, 37. Yeah, and you know, he immediately confronted then the birth defect of a massive fiscal crisis. Right? That suddenly those oil revenues that are there, that are irrigating this system, have shrunk by half and more. And he had to immediately push through an austerity budget, as you all know. So all I'm trying to say is he immediately confronted two very severe problems. and then trying in the context of austerity, fiscal crisis, declining oil prices, right, to have that as something that you immediately have to address, and yet, and then confronting these sorts of questions. Well, the good news you could say is maybe this will compel this administration and hopefully a class of politicians to say, we can't do business as usual. If business as usual is handing out money, trying to purchase, because there is no money there. You see what I'm saying? So in a sense, what I'm calling that birth, that might then, what, and I haven't answered a question, what I consider Mr. Buhari has done well or not. I'm just simply saying that there is now this provisioning pact, if you want to call it that, is confronting now a very big birth defect. And that can go in all sorts of ways. I'm not saying that will necessarily produce a good, but you have to see that as potentially a type of opportunity, that the old system of provisioning simply won't work anymore. Thank you very much.